wondered about the secret life of a classical musician? You might have seen a musician's grand entrance on stage, their precision in performance, their passion in each sacred moment of beauty. And you might wonder, what's underneath? How did they get to this point? What's it like to be them? This evening, Astral Artists invites you to an up-close and personal view of what goes on behind the scenes in order to make a musician. We'll open the door to one musician's practice room and intern to her daily practice experience. Through fascinating conversation and through some great music, we will spend an intimate evening uncovering a few secrets that musicians hold in order to keep going in our ever-changing world. And we might just find that those secrets to a musician's success aren't only applicable in a practice room or concert hall, but often find themselves at home in any area and walk of life. So come on into the living room, pull up a chair by the fire, and make yourself at home as we begin this Astral Nova event featuring harpist Rachel Lee Hall.
Hello and welcome. I'm Rachel, a classical harpist, performer, and teacher. I'm also a social media influencer on Instagram with a community of about 50,000 followers. A good chunk of those followers are young music students and aspiring professional musicians. So I'm always looking for ways to inspire them to keep going, keep practicing, and keep reaching for their highest potential. So last year, I kept getting messages in my inbox with questions about how to practice. They would range anywhere from how long should I practice to how should I use my metronome. But then it was interesting because some more serious questions started rolling in. Questions like, do you think I have what it takes? How do I stay motivated? Or what if I fail? The more I read these messages, the more I realized that there needed to be some more resources out there for practicers. Not just about the practical side of how to practice, but about those deeper questions. So I wrote a book called Purpose in Practice, 26 Rules for the Practicing Musician. It's a practice guide with 26 rules for a healthy practice life. Some of them are on the more practical side, but most of them delve in deeper to encourage musicians to find true meaning in their practice and ultimately in their life as well. To go with it, I also created a practice journal. The journal is filled with gorgeous illustrations by my older brother, Jared, and it's designed to be fun and inspiring with coloring pages and habit trackers and even inspirational quotes. So each practice week reveals one of the 26 secrets from the handbook to keep in mind throughout the week for a total of 6 months of practicing. Today, I'm excited to share with you a few of the secrets from my book, which I have found to be most helpful in my own life, and some stories to go with them. I'm also very excited to be weaving those stories together with some great music, including this lovely arrangement of Puccini's Musetta's Waltz by Yolanda Contenasis.
Thank you.
I'm often inspired by the extraordinary athlete Glenn Cunningham. When Glenn was only 7 years old, he was caught in a terrible fire at school, and he suffered burns so bad that doctors said he would never walk again. Now, what inspires me about Glenn is that at only the age of 7, he wouldn't take no for an answer. He defied the odds because he was fueled with a purpose that not only enabled him to walk again, but run. He ran his way toward winning his first race at the age of 12, and then he went on to win several awards through college, and he kept running all the way to the Olympics, where he was awarded a silver medal. Now, Glenn proved the point that infusing your life with purpose will give you all the motivation necessary for success. I encourage all my students to make sure that at the root of their practice sessions, there's an underlying purpose that keeps them running toward excellence. And not just any purpose, one that's worthwhile, one that's bigger than themselves, and one that reaches out into the community to benefit others. Now, I sometimes listen to the masterpieces of Johann Sebastian Bach, and I wonder, just how was he able to produce so many thousands of works at such a high level? I mean, not only good music, but music that has stood the test of time for centuries. And then I remember that at the bottom of his pieces that he wrote, the symbol SDG appears. It stands for Soli Deo Gloria, or glory to God alone. Now, Bach's purpose was his faith, which fueled him with an energy to meaningfully charge through the seemingly humdrum details of paper and ink, trial and error, and produce something that aimed not at his own glory, but at a greater cause that would extend far beyond himself, his town, and even his lifetime. Now, I believe that if you find your purpose, you'll be willing to do whatever it takes to fulfill it, and those humdrum practice sessions will start to take on new meaning. It takes a whole lot of hard work to become successful, 10,000 hours of deliberate practice and careful attention to detail, and plenty of nose to the grind, slow and steady work. But once you're fueled with true purpose, all the humdrum transforms into joy and excitement to make your purpose come to life.
Thank you.
I'm often asked the question, how are you staying afloat as a musician this year during the COVID-19 pandemic? My answer is that those who band together stand together. Now more than ever, the value of community cannot be quantified. And regardless of whether this happens in person or virtually, my best advice for continuing successfully amidst today's uncharted waters is to band together with a community of people who will encourage you, challenge you, uphold you, and help you grow. When you band yourself together, even in the darkest and most uncertain times, those times can transform into the most exciting of adventures. One of the best things about this past year was being able to band together, even during quarantine, with other brilliant artists to connect with, collaborate with, and to mutually inspire. And one such musician is cellist Justin Hall. Justin is not only an extraordinary performer, he's also a scholar specializing in literature, music history, and philosophy, and he happens to be my younger brother. Because we're family, collaborating was easy during quarantine, and we produced a few exciting projects, one of which we present to you tonight. Justin and I combined our mutual love of art song and of literature to transcribe this beautiful work by Roger Quilter. The work is originally for piano and voice, with the text of each song being a poem by William Shakespeare, and we recreated this work for harp and cello. Now, the poignancy of art song is that the music works to vividly depict the text. And so our goal with this project was to separate the text from the music in such a way that the music speaks for itself. I feel very fortunate to be able to band together with my brother Justin for this premiere performance of Roger Quilter's three Shakespeare songs for harp and cello.
Thank you.
Once we know our purpose, it's much easier to stay motivated. But the hard part for me is not forgetting my purpose when life gets overwhelming. My favorite way to keep my mind focused on that goal is to continually break it down into smaller and smaller goals. I first think big scale and say to myself, what do I most want to achieve in my whole life? And then I say, what can I do in 10 years to get closer to that goal? And then what can I do in 5 years or in 1 year? And finally, I break it down to the very week, day, and even by the hour. That type of organization not only helps to remind me of my purpose, but it gives me small and totally achievable stepping stones toward getting there. It really puts a new spin on the phrase, follow your dreams. It's not a head in the clouds, wishy-washy sort of follow your dreams, but it's an intentional mapping out of every stepping stone to get there. I remember when I was about 12 years old, I would listen to the recordings of my favorite harpist in the world, Yolanda Contenasis. I'd sit on my couch at home and listen to all her albums. I would just dream of playing just like her one day. My biggest dream at the time was to get the chance to study with her. So when my dad did some research and discovered that she taught at the Cleveland Institute of Music, I made it my goal to get into her studio. I practiced hard, I told my private teacher my plans, and I dreamed away. And all the while, I was stepping closer and closer to the goal. Finally, as a senior in high school, I auditioned at CIM, and to my delight, I was accepted. My 5 years with Ms. Contenasis was more wonderful than I could have ever imagined, and I owe so much to Ms. Contenasis for all she taught me and all the purposes and dreams that I discovered along the way. As a tribute to Ms. Contenasis, the next piece is one of her own compositions, Dream Season, for two harps, with both harps being played by myself in a multi-track presentation. The piece is meant to depict the wonder of the winter season, and I find that the scope of the piece, starting in tonal simplicity and building to its eventual climax, represents perfectly those careful, courageous stepping stones we should take when we follow our dreams.
Thank you.
In such a competitive music world, our performances are scrutinized and judged harshly. To make it as a classical musician basically requires us to be perfect, and that's a requirement that is actually unachievable. The stakes are really high, and the danger for us classical musicians is to turn on ourselves and become so critical that we spiral into despair. Now, instead of our practice sessions being driven by purpose, they end up being driven by fear, and we become our own worst critics. Because of this trend among musicians, I've decided to embrace the fact that I'm my own worst critic and use it to my advantage instead. To me, being my own worst critic means that because I know myself better than anyone, I'm actually the one most equipped to critique myself. And suddenly, being my own worst critic stops being negative at all, and instead helps me grow. Now, why is that? Well, it's because it takes the focus off of what people think of me. I can use my inner critic to expect the greatest things of myself in the practice room out of respect for myself rather than out of fear of others. And then, when I get to a performance, my inner critic almost ceremoniously deems me worthy to perform. I can tell myself that there's actually no greater critic in the audience than myself, and since my inner critic says I'm worthy, I'll be just fine. And one of my favorite ways that I've developed my inner critic is by regularly posting practice clips to Instagram. It can sometimes be daunting posting all the time to such a large audience, but as I've embraced being my own worst critic, I've more and more been able to focus on posting to inspire rather than posting to impress. In January, just last month, hundreds of Instagram harpists joined a challenge to learn their dream piece in only 1 month. Now, I joined the challenge and I chose the beautiful Fantasy by Camille Saint-Saëns, one I hadn't yet gotten the chance to perform, and participating in the challenge was immensely inspiring. As I think about it, it really was the combination of all the secrets we talked about today. We were all being our own worst critics by expecting the best of ourselves. We were all banding together into a community with one common goal. We were fueled with purpose, and we were following our dreams. And the result? Inspiration. This last performance of the evening is the result of that challenge and my first performance ever of the Fantasy for Solo Harp by Camille Saint-Saëns. Thank you for being my audience tonight, and as always, for your support to Astral Artists. I'm so grateful you decided to sit by the fire with me tonight.
Thank you.